This is the lecture for European history for Tuesday, the 23rd of February 2021. Wasn't sure of the date. So, we have been looking at the various regions of the world, and you've got to understand something about non-European history. Because you're here at Charter, you are deeply vested in Western civilization, which is necessary and natural, since you are inheritors of Western civilization. And also, since Western civilization is the first and only global civilization. Having said that, because we are here in the West, there is a tendency not to understand that for everywhere else in the world, the three ages of history are not ancient, medieval, and modern. I mean, they have an ancient period and a medieval period, too. Don't get me wrong. But what really matters is their history pre-contact and their history from European contact through European imperialism, and then their post-colonial history. These three eras are distinct and different everywhere else in the world. In the Middle East, in Africa, both north and south of the Sahara, in South Asia, which is what we're covering right now, in East Asia, in Oceania and the Pacific, in Latin America, in North America. What matters most in terms of shaping these societies is European contact and European conquest or domination. And if you are of a modern masochistic frame of mind, you might think, oh, what a horrible thing for the world. Well, yes and no. Like fire, like gunpowder, like atomic power, there are good and bad sides to every development. Like the Roman Empire, there are good and bad sides to every development. On the bad side, if you believe that each native culture has its value and therefore, that each native culture should be preserved as if it's some kind of endangered species, then European contact and conquest was an absolute unmitigated disaster because these cultures weren't just encountered and conquered. These cultures were encountered, conquered, and rendered obsolete. Not simply to the European mind, but to the minds of the natives. Now you might say, what about those revolutionary leaders that came about during the age of imperialism? All of them, without exception, were educated by Europeans or in European fashion, or adopted European-style ideas. What the Taiping tried to do in China, the communists eventually do. The Taiping tried it and failed. The nationalists, the Kuomintang, try it and fail in the early 20th century. The communists try it and succeed in the mid to late 20th century. And that is inoculate themselves against the West by adopting a Western idea, Sinicizing it, that's Chinifying it, and then using it to drive the Westerners out. Also exploiting divisions within the West, for example, between the communist Russians and the free world. Analogs of this exist in Africa and South Asia, all across the world, where there were nationalist uprisings. In fact, the very concept of nationalism as opposed to tribalism is a European concept. So, it is not a matter of cultural pride when I say that the most important event in these societies is pre-contact, contact, and imperialism, and then post-imperialism. It is a matter of objective fact, at least in terms of, you could argue, the modern history of these societies. But I would say that the changes wrought by Europe are at least as great as any alteration between ancient and medieval forms within these societies. But lest you start thinking that the worst thing ever to happen to the world is us, remember that it's the reflexive, self-conscious agonizing over whether or not what we our ancestors have done is right that is quintessentially Western. That Western civilization develops progressive ideas and liberal ideas and modern ideas that are both secular and humane. That all of these societies, being pre-industrial, had slavery in one form or another. That all of these societies, without exception, viewed women as somewhere between people and property. That all of these societies, without exception, were authoritarian, hierarchical, and where concepts of natural or human rights was not universally applied. Those things come from the industrial West. They come from Christianity or Judeo-Christian values. They come from industrial ideas applied to in service of those values. And what our ancestors brought to the rest of the world, our cultural ancestors, is nothing less than a possibility to free themselves of premature death due to preventable diseases, due to drinking water fouled by their own waste, due to engaging in farming techniques that are genuinely obsolete, providing medicine, education, and the opportunity for a modern life. If there's a great tragedy in the post-colonial world, it's that Europe wasn't there long enough. Here's a point of view that you can consider and agree or disagree with. To take Robert Ruark's notion of something of value, we were in Kenya just long enough to destroy the native balance in society. But we were not long enough there long enough, we being our British cultural ancestors, we were not there long enough to instill in them genuine Western restraint, Western notions of the value of each life, Western notions of freedom, of dignity, of human rights, and freedom of conscience, and all that stuff. So the history of sub-Saharan Africa particularly, but also of Latin America and post-colonial Asia in many respects, is a history of one group getting control of the coercive powers of the modern state. The supervisory powers provided by electronics, the physical power provided by modern guns, modern weaponry, and the amazing potentiality in dental equipment to provide pain selectively to victims who might have information that you want. Dental equipment, one of the great inventions applied in completely unexpected ways. And if you doubt me, imagine the last time you were at the dentist hoping that things wouldn't get bad. One wouldn't think that dental equipment is one of the key developments, but it actually is. And it's used by almost every tin pot third world dictatorship to terrorize its enemies and extract information. We're going to be studying this more in the case of Unit 4. There are several cases where this did not happen, thank goodness. India, for example, with all of its problems, has had a largely democratic and humanitarian regime since colonial times. There were periods where they allied with the Soviets. The current government is Hindu nationalist, so it's not particularly open to cooperation with the Muslims. But the Muslims, since before 1947 and the independence of India, weren't particularly interested in cooperation with the Hindus. So that seems reasonable. Scary thing is they fought several wars with one another, and now they both have nuclear weapons. And there isn't a single place, except maybe the central Thar Desert, in the entire subcontinent that you could detonate even a small atomic weapon and not cause megadeath. So, this European contact that we're talking about is a mixed bag. With the contact comes the potential of truly raising living standards in the third world. And in fact, after the Cold War, with the Pax Americana world that we've had since the fall of the Soviets, the diet of average third world peoples has radically improved. The problem is not physical. It's not a problem of having enough food in the world. There's plenty, thanks to American farmers and farmers that use modern techniques. The problem is political. If you could discover a famine in some benighted part of the world, look closely at it. And unless it's a direct result of some kind of natural disaster, it is likely a result of political action. Especially in sub-Saharan Africa, food is used as a weapon against tribal enemies. The tribe that controls the national government controls the distribution of food. Back in the 1980s, there was a big kerfuffle over famine in Ethiopia. And Westerners, particularly rock musicians, tried raising money globally through a series of charity concerts and albums. And huge amounts of money were raised. What they didn't understand, for the most part, is that the famine in the Ogaden region of Ethiopia was caused by the Mengistu government, a communist regime that viewed the people of the Ogaden as their enemies. So they simply shut off the food supply. The famine was not a result of natural causes. It was not even a result of living where the sand is and not where the food grows. It was a result of government action. And those very same well-intentioned progressive rockers that raised all that money gave most of it to the very Mengistu regime that caused the famine in the first place. And in return for ludicrous amounts of money, that regime permitted a trickle of food to get to the people that the rockers were very interested in saving. The same sort of food politics brought the United States into Somalia in 1993, at the end of 1992, beginning of 1993, with long-term results of mass Somali immigration into the United States. So what I'm teaching is among the most significant things to the modern world that we've covered so far. It is the time when Europe dominated these areas. For good and for ill, the effects are dramatic, and most of the people on Earth are feeling them. Personally, I will share that I absolutely believe Ruark's thesis. We were there just long enough to destroy what was naturally evolved, but we weren't there nearly long enough to genuinely civilize the natives in our manner. As a result, without any of the natural restraints of their indigenous cultures, modern tools of oppression were given to tribal groups within societies who used them without restraint against their tribal enemies. It's a horror show. But there's hope. There's always hope. Okay. In the 1840s, the British East India Company had developed a degree of comfort in their control over Indian politics. Through using divide-and-conquer methods, the Hindus were played against the Muslims, were played against the Sikhs, were played against the Bengali speakers, were played against the Hindi speakers, were played against the Caucasians, were played against the Dravidians, the Tamils, the Nepalese. And all of these divisions kept the Indian factions fighting one another for British support, instead of fighting the British. In fact, the notions of all of the subcontinent coming together in any common cause is alien to pre-contact India. The area is deeply divided, arguably more deeply divided than Europe ever was. However, BEIC makes a colossal stupid error, easy to see in hindsight. As technology was improving, one of the early cartridge firearms required the soldier to pull off a tab on the cartridge before loading the weapon. The tab sealed in some lubricant. You would pull the tab off with your teeth and then place the cartridge in the weapon. The lubricant was made of beef tallow. Beef tallow is cow fat. Now, if you have any memory of what we were talking about last class, or if you have any understanding of Hinduism, you can see the problem. Indians who are Hindu are not supposed to have anything to do with the slaughter of cows. And you are asking soldiers to put cow tallow in their mouths. What resulted was the Sepoy Indian Mutiny, the bloodiest event of the British Raj, where Indian soldiers around the country rose up and threw off the British East India Company, or at least fought them to a bloody standstill. What had seemed to be a fairly placid region of the empire suddenly united in flaming rebellion. So the result of the Sepoy Indian Mutiny was that Britain sent in many more resources to crush it, which they do, using Indian troops that were not Hindu against Indian troops that were, particularly Muslims, but also getting rid of the East India Company entirely, blaming the BEIC for the boneheaded decision to use tallow. I mean, this is worse than the Chevrolet company in the early 1970s, marketing a car to Latin America called the Nova. Now, to us, Nova is an exploding star, bright and brilliant and energetic. Any Spanish students in here? What does the word Nova mean? Or what do the words Nova mean? Va? Voy vas va?
Oh.
Vamos va? What? No go. Yeah. Nova means no go. Why the heck would a Spanish-speaking person buy a no go? But, you know, people just don't understand. So, this is far worse than that. After the Sepoy Indian Mutiny, the British government directly takes over India. And Queen Victoria is made the Empress of India. So from that point, she is the Queen Empress. And up until Indian independence in 1947, the British monarchs were king emperors or queen empresses. Because as emperor or empress of India, the British monarch was the highest ranking noble in the entire land. And so all of the divisions within India were retained. The company was blamed and gotten rid of, and the imperial government could be considered the referee between all of the various squabbling Indian factions.
I can't remember exactly where I heard this, but if it's true, it's a really interesting fact. It's that the Dutch East India Company is the biggest business, or the biggest company to ever exist.
Yes.
In modern money, I think it's like $13 billion.
I wouldn't deny it. The Dutch are strange, and I don't focus much on them because in our time, the Dutch are a fairly minor power. But in the 1600s and 1700s, you're absolutely right. Now, the Dutch East India Company doesn't deal with British India. It deals with what we call Indonesia, Malaysia, those islands between Australia and Southeast Asia. But the spices that came and come out of modern Indonesia, the old Dutch East Indies, were the stuff that fortunes were made of. And at that time, the Dutch had a fairly tight monopoly on certain spices and certain substances. So they made lots of money. The Dutch actually made so much money that their economy was overheated to the point in the 1600s, and I may have mentioned this, where people were so desperate to invest in things that the Dutch at home started investing in tulips, in ever more increasing the rare and exotic and beautiful types of tulips. And then one day, somebody woke up and said, "I just mortgaged my house to get some tulips." They're flowers! And the economy collapses in what's called the Great Tulip Depression. No joke, it destroys Holland's economy for decades. It's horrible. People kill themselves. But you can't make this stuff up. The Great Tulip Depression. Look it up. But yeah, it was a result of the hyper energizing of the economy brought about by the Dutch East India Company.
Excellent. Didn't they have like their own military too?
Yeah. Oh, look, British East India had their own military. The Dutch East India did too. Yeah, definitely. And it was one of the most powerful militaries on Earth, both of them in their time. But ultimately, both national governments take over from their companies, and there are reasons for this. If you have a for-profit corporation exploiting a colony, what will happen eventually is the natives of that colony will just get irritated to such an extent that they're going to rise up. National governments, because they're political, have a greater sense of political value, and they did better at keeping the natives in line from rebelling. Okay, and the Raj does the same thing. Do you have anything?
Sorry, no.
No, I'm not yelling at you. You're very attentive. It's just if you had something interesting to say.
Oh, no.
Okay. So that's what it's called. It's called the Raj. Not Rajesh, who's from Bali, but I can't believe I remember his name. That's from a TV show called The Big Bang Theory. The Raj means the imperial era. A Raja is an emperor in Hindi. So the Raj is the imperial period where the British rule India. And it is the jewel in the crown of the British Empire because the subcontinent is a major economic region of the world. And with a few exceptions like Portuguese Goa, or French Pondicherry. For the most part, it is under British dominion. So Britain develops mightily as a result of controlling the Indian subcontinent. And where we're going to leave it is sort of looking ahead. Because the Raj was open to having Indians of all types go to British schools, a young man from a very, very high-caste Hindu family, Mohandas K. Gandhi, ends up going to British universities and becoming a lawyer. Mohandas K. Gandhi then goes to South Africa, which we're going to talk about in detail next, and ends up being the major advocate for Indian rights in South Africa. Because in South Africa in the late 18 and the very early 1900s, your race defined everything about you. It wasn't the apartheid regime, it was just the way South Africa was run. If you were Bantu or black, very low class. If you were of mixed blood, lower middle class. If you were Indian, around where the mixed bloods are, lower middle class. If you were English, upper middle class. And if you were Dutch, upper class. Dutch Afrikaners. So Gandhi didn't like the fact that the Indians were being treated so badly as a class of people. So he learned to apply some of Tolstoy's ideas of civil disobedience. Gandhi perfects these techniques in South Africa, and then during World War I returns to British India, his homeland. A famous person who becomes instrumental in moving India from British rule to independence, for better or worse. Spoiler alert, his reward for it was that a Hindu nationalist assassinated him within a year of Indian independence. You can't please somebody. You just can't. We'll talk more about him, Unit 4. And if you ever get a chance to see the movie from the 80s by David Attenborough called Gandhi, it is well worth seeing. It's a hero pick. It's a hagiography. Pictures Gandhi as a saint, whereas he was a lawyer. But it does a good job, as long as you take that into account. Okay. Africa. We've talked about Egypt and the Suez Canal. You shouldn't have any further questions about that. Because of the development of quinine, explorers begin to go deep into the heart of Africa, deepest, darkest Africa. And a question was, what is the source of the Nile? They didn't understand yet that the source of the Nile were a bunch of rivers around Lake Victoria. There were some legends of mountains, so-called mountains of the moon, in East Africa that would have had snows that would have flowed and become the Nile. With quinine, British people began exploring the heart of Africa. There's one guy named David Livingstone. And Livingstone is a missionary, a Christian missionary. I've got to reach over you. I apologize. Livingstone comes in from Western Africa up the Congo River, looking for the source of the Congo River to see if it is, and the Congo River is the great river of Central Africa, to see if the source of the Congo River is those mythical mountains of the moon. Livingstone then disappears for years. Nobody hears from him. What he's doing is living among several native tribes, missionizing to them. He's also making observations about landforms and life forms and, you know, science stuff. So he's a scientific missionary. From the other coast, Sir Richard Burton, not the actor, but the guy that the actor names himself after, who's a great explorer in the British Empire, enters Africa from the Mombasa shore near Kenya and begins going inland from there. And Burton ends up finding Lake Victoria. He goes into Burundi and Rwanda for the first time, and he develops a sense that the Nile comes from these mountains, that there are no mythical mountains of the moon, but there is a great rift canyon in East Africa. And on the other extreme, right next to the rift canyon, are a bunch of volcanic mountains like Mount Kenya and Mount Kilimanjaro. However, the British are concerned about Livingstone, and they want to find out what happened. So a second expedition under William Stanley ends up going up, going deep into the heart of darkest Africa to try to find Livingstone. And soon Stanley is beyond where any white man has ever been. And, you know, traveling through jungles that seem primeval except for the natives. And there aren't many natives because it's hard to live in these jungles. The pygmies live in these jungles. Sometimes cannibals live in these jungles. Because believe it or not, while surrounded by life, sometimes it's impossible to get enough protein without eating long pig, which is us. It's the same reason why people on what seem like paradisical Pacific islands end up going cannibal, like in Fiji, because there just isn't enough protein in their diets.
I don't remember where it was. I think it may have been in Africa, but I watched a documentary with my family a while ago about this group of cannibals that live very in like a very secluded area, but it was interesting.
Was it Africa or the Pacific or somewhere else?
I think it may have been the Pacific, actually.
Okay. Because in all of these jungle regions, including South America, including Southeast Asia, there are pockets of cannibals. And it does have to do with this paradox that you're surrounded by life, but you have difficulty taking in enough protein.
I watched another documentary that was about a similar topic, except it was about a very secluded island like off the coast of India.
Yeah.
And there was, like, planes that flew overhead, and every single time, like, a ship goes too close, like, it gets rained with arrows.
Yeah,
because
yeah. Yeah, I've heard of that place. That's an interesting story. And the fact that they are still doing it,
yeah,
is also quite interesting. I probably will tell you when we do more Southeast Asia stuff about the cargo cult, but I'll at least mention it now. When I used to teach geography, that was a big deal. In Papua New Guinea, there probably still are people that have never encountered an outsider. These are in the Owen Stanley Mountains of an island that is huge and jungle and dense. And in the 60s, they were still discovering tribes that had never contacted the outside world. But as anthropologists in the 50s and 60s start going into the depths of the interior of Papua New Guinea, what they found were bamboo statues of what could only be aircraft. Not angels, not demons, but aircraft. And when they encountered the tribes, they were wearing masks that looked like technology from World War II. Well, what happened was the Owen Stanley Mountains and the jungles of Papua New Guinea were a major battleground between Australian and American troops on the one hand and Japanese troops coming in from the north on the other hand. these tribes that had had no prior contact with outsiders suddenly saw air battles over their heads between what they only could interpret as angels and demons. And sometimes people landed and they seemed different. And so what develops is what's called the cargo cult, which is a cult based on things that fell from the heavens and equipment that was found in the jungles as a result of that intense, like, year and a half long battle between us and the Japanese. And it is an interesting cultural study because it's a fairly recent religion, and it's a religion that we can trace the origins of precisely. Anyway, there's a wonderful movie, well, if you like that sort of thing, called The Gods Must Be Crazy. And it's based on the story of a Hottentot, or a Kukum, an African bushman of the Kalahari Desert in northern South Africa and in what's now Namibia. A plane flying from overhead, drops a bottle, an empty bottle of Coke. And in those days, Coke bottles were built. They were tough. They were made of glass. Now, the natives had never had anything in their world that was hard before, except for occasional rocks. They lived in a world of sand and a world of soil and a world of trees, and everything was shared in common. This was an idealized version of Old Stone Age peoples. And the Hottentots, or the Kung are, or the Bushmen are Old Stone Age peoples. Still exist. But the arrival of this Coke bottle changes everything. Suddenly, people fight over it, and you have, it's like the serpent in the Garden of Eden. It's a comedy of culture. And I have to be in the mood to see it. But it's kind of neat. Gods Must Be Crazy, if you're interested. Okay. Colonial regions of Africa. The French control Northwest Africa, the British control the Nile Valley up to where Kenya is, and the south. The Belgians, tiny little Belgium, ends up taking over the Congo River region in central West Africa. And the, yeah.
There's actually a sequel to The Gods Must Be Crazy.
Yeah, I've never seen it. The idea of there being a sequel just seemed to make no sense to me. But, yeah, where there's money to be made. And it actually was a very successful movie back in its day. Now, the Belgians didn't claim the Congo region for their nation. It was a private venture by King Leopold of Belgium. Because it was a private venture of King Leopold of Belgium, he gets the best of both worlds. On the one hand, the Congo, this massive region of Central Africa, is colored the Belgian colors on every world map. And there are lots of natural resources in the Belgian Congo. That's true. However, he doesn't have to answer to the Belgian parliament or the Belgian government. He can do whatever he wants. In the late 1800s and early 1900s, the Belgian Congo was synonymous with mass murder and atrocities. The ivory trade was plied there with elephants. Any tribe that even harmed a Belgian was liable to be decimated. That means one-tenth of their population killed, or worse. The Belgians literally enslaved the natives and put them to work in mines, in open strip mines, and deforestation, and a bunch of things like that. This nice, civilized country in the heart of Europe, known for its chocolates and its endives and its waffles, and known as a victim of German and French aggression over the centuries, becomes the absolute worst colonial power in this period in terms of being utterly, unapologetically vicious to the native population. The Belgian Congo is still synonymous with evil colonial rule. Now, initially, the southern region of Africa was unpopulated. Human population may have come from Central East Africa, but that's above the ceiling. And there are huge distances because Africa is bigger than it seems on that map. Also, the climate is no longer tropical or subtropical. It's actually temperate the closer you get to the southern region. So the only people who migrated here were the Bushmen or the Hottentots or the Kung, depending upon which term you want to use. And most of them settle loosely up here in the Kalahari region. Whether there were any humans when the Dutch arrived in 1600, or whether the native peoples of the Hottentots or the Bushmen passed through, they probably did pass through the entire southern African region, is unclear. But the Dutch arrived as some of the first humans and the first humans to permanently settle in the very around 1600. And they establish Cape Colony in Cape Town. For 200 years, the Dutch live. These are Reformed Dutch Christians. They're a bit like the Pilgrims and the Puritans in that they want to be left alone to practice their religion without any interference from Europe or its politics. But they enslave the African population. This is the 1600s, not the 1800s. It's the time when the triangle trade is taking off. And culturally, it makes total sense to make the plantation slaves of Cape Colony just as it was natural for the southern plantation owners in the United States or in Jamaica or Haiti to enslave the native population or bring in African slaves to work on the sugar plantations there. Britain arrives during the Napoleonic Wars around the year 1800, and the British take over Cape Colony. The Dutch are not going to make a fight of it, just like they didn't make a fight over when the British took over New York, which had been New Amsterdam in the 1600s. The Dutch accepted it. So the British take over Cape Colony. Why? Because the French now control Holland under Napoleon. And the British don't want the French to have a base at one of the world's major geographical maritime choke points. So the British take over Cape Colony, and the Dutch abide it. They're not thrilled, but they abide it. Until Wilberforce, in the early 1800s, who wants to end slavery. And the British Parliament outlaws slavery within the empire. Suddenly, the Afrikaners, the Dutch who had lived here for now about 225, 230 years, are being told that their way of life, which includes slavery, is no longer acceptable to the British. So they decide to do something that makes total sense from an American point of view. That's a bad thing. They leave. They vote with their feet. The Afrikaners, the farmers, the Boers, engage in what is called the Voortrek. And the Voortrek is, the trek is an Afrikaans word that means journey. Star Trek includes an Afrikaans word. Afrikaans is the language of the Dutch Africans, the Afrikaners, which has drifted from European Dutch quite considerably. So the Voortrek is the flight from British rule to find their own new promised land. But there's a problem that the Dutch encounter. And the problem comes from a minor African tribe in the early 1820s. This tribe is cradled north of the Drakensberg Mountains. They're called the Zulus. Now, the Zulus are one of many tribes in that area. Again, a fairly minor tribe. But a bastard child named Shaka, who is born under a propitious astronomical sign. And there are stories about his birth that involve witchcraft and the spirits of the ancestors and a bunch of other things. What we know about Shaka is this. Despite his low birth, he becomes a leader of men in battle. Now, up to this point, battle between the tribes of southern Africa, which were basically Iron Age tribes, involved almost a ritual dance, like the kind of martial arts you see in certain kinds of movies that are clearly dancing. They're not fighting, they're dancing. They're not trying to hurt one another. They're actually trying not to hurt one another. So, what they use is what's called the assegai. And what the assegai is, A-S-S-E-G-A-I, is a throwing spear, like a javelin. It's fairly long, it's fairly thin, it's got a small iron tip, And the Zulu warriors and the other warriors would tend to wear grass greaves or leggings under the knee, and they would have a cowhide shield. The cowhide shield is good enough to catch a tossed javelin and deflect it from a person. And what the tribes would do is they'd get close enough to one another to start yelling at one another and singing at one another and chanting at one another and insulting each other's mommy. You're ugly and your mom dresses you funny and all this stuff. And from time to time, they'd wing javelins. And the first tribe that blinked would lose the battle. The battles were relatively light in terms of casualties because people, when they realized that they were just overmatched in a given situation, would retreat. Shaka said, "We're not dancing. We're fighting." And he designs a new weapon called the Ikwa. I-K-W-A. The Ikwa is about this long. But instead of having a small little piercing tip made of iron, the Ikwa has a blade that basically goes from here to about here. So, say, two-thirds to three-quarters of the weapon. That is a blade. The Ikwa is not designed for throwing. Its balance is all off. You can wing it, maybe hit something if you're lucky. The Ikwa is designed in the same way that the Russian gladius is designed. I'm sure you learned last year, the Romans designed all of their equipment to fight in unison. In Roman times, the best weapons for an individual warrior are a spatha, that's a long sword, about this long, and a round shield that's small enough to maneuver. And if you're an individual warrior fighting, that's what you want, a long sword and a small shield. The Romans reverse this. They have these massive tower shields that they walk around with that are rectangular, and they have little bitty swords called the gladius. That's because after throwing their javelins, I'm not going to get too deep into it, the Romans' tactic is to march close up to the enemy, knock their weapon aside, and do an uppercut thrust under their ribcage into their heart. Blade goes in, blade goes out, next. The Romans were a machine. Uppercut thrust under the ribcage, dead. Zip, zop, next. Dead, next. The Romans turned battle from this glorious heroic thing into engineering. And they won an empire by doing it. Shaka does the same thing. He says, we're not going to dance. We'll sing a little bit, and then we're going to charge. And we will gut them with our Ikwa. We get close, we knock their weapon aside, and we kill them, and we move on. We're not trying to avoid casualties. We want to inflict casualties. We're not trying to handle our fear by mitigating it. We're trying to confront our fear and become more terrifying than anything we might be afraid of. Shaka's methods of war expand Zulu territory from its tiny heart to include a massive region north of the Drakensberg. However, Shaka is a tyrant. His kraals, or cattle enclosure slash villages, are places where his men have total reign and where nobody can even look at them funny. He is an emperor. In fact, the Zulus are often compared to the Romans of South Africa because of the way they fight, and Shaka is something between Gaius Marius, Julius Caesar, and Caesar Augustus, all rolled up into one. He reforms their military and establishes their empire. But Shaka is hated as well as admired, and he is assassinated at the orders of a relative named Inanne. After Shaka's assassination, each of the great generals of his empire, this is redolent of Alexander the Great's generals, takes a set of MP, a Zulu MP is a Zulu legion, and goes in a different direction, conquers until they find a land they want to occupy. So they fight their way through and then they occupy. Western Zimbabwe is occupied by the Matabele or Ndebele tribe. The Ndebele or the Matabele are a Zulu people from the expansion. Now, the Zulu word for expansion is the Mfecane. The Mfecane happens at Shaka's death, where the generals of the Zulu Empire go into all sorts of different directions to conquer a massive region of southern Africa. The Mfecane happens at about the same time as the Voortrek. So these two peoples are going to come into direct conflict. The Dutch and the Africans fight a series of what the Dutch call Kafir Wars. The word Kafir or Kafir comes from the Arabic, and it means unbeliever. It is what a Arab will call a Christian or a Jew. They're Kafirs, they're Kafirs, they're unbelievers. If you're a cook, you might know what Kafir limes are. They're limes of the unbelievers. The Dutch Afrikaans word for nigger, and I use that term because that's how they meant it, is Kafir. So if you hear a Southern African talking about Kafirs in an old movie, that's what it means. And so the Dutch fight a series of Kafir wars against the expanding Zulu. Again and again, the Dutch are confronted by superior numbers, but they've got guns. It's literally like old cowboys and Indians movies. In fact, our cowboys take a page from the book of the Voortrekkers, because what the Voortrekkers will do at places like Blood River and other battles is they'll circle their wagons into what is called a lager. A lager is a fortress made out of circled wagons. The horses are brought inside, the wagons are sometimes turned on their sides, and you've got walls. And the Zulu may try to approach. The Zulu were not mounted, they were foot soldiers. And the Dutch would fight them with guns. And sometimes the Zulu won, because they're incredible fighters, and sometimes the Dutch won, the Boers won, the Voortrekkers won, the Afrikaners won. Well, what eventually happens is the Afrikaners fight their way past a number of Zulu tribes, armies, MP, that are expanding. And the Dutch established two homelands in the deep interior. You've got Zulu areas like Bechuanaland up here, what's now Botswana, the Matabele or Ndebele of Zimbabwe, and you've got a number of other Zulu people. But right in the heart, you've got the Orange Free State and the Transvaal. The Orange Free State is named that because of the Dutch Reformed religion and because of the Orange River that flows through the center. The Transvaal is the Dutch Afrikaner state north of the Vaal River. And these two states pull away from the British to live their own lives. And the Zulu and the Boers hate one another, but they admire one another because they have fought through one another, and they appreciate how good fighters each is. And each culture respects warfare and great warriors. In the 1860s, the British take over Natal on the coast south of the Drakensberg Mountains. In the 1870s, there are rumors of precious metal strikes being found in the Orange Free State, in Transvaal, and in other regions, and the British want into the interior. Some of them are going to follow the Voortrekkers from Cape Town. That's hugely far away. British try moving across the Drakensberg from Natal. The Zulu don't like it. In 1879, a war starts between the Zulu and the British Empire, which we are going to study in detail because it is a good example of a colonial war. That's where we'll leave it for today. You may talk quietly among yourselves until dismissal, and I suppose you at home can do that too.